Well, look, this debate, which is on a substitute section 8, has perforce gravitated towards a discussion of the section 8 that is already in the bill. And that's no surprise, because in essence it's quite clear that this section is designed to preempt any measure such as section 8 without a baseline data study being put in place to justify it. I do think, though, there are a few points that we have to consider about what is being proposed here. The Minister has indicated that road safety is one of the issues which concerns her and motivates this legislation. But if that is the case, I would like to see some mention of road safety as one of the criteria for making regulations in the section. In her section, when we come to it. It seems to me that if that is one of the genuine motivating factors here, one would expect it to appear as one of the grounds on which one of the criteria by which regulations would be crafted. But we don't see that. The second point that the Minister, and it seems to me, in a spirit of genuine conciliation in this debate, it seems to me that the Minister should indicate that she is open to accepting the introduction of road safety as a constraining factor, as one of the constraining factors if in Section 8, if her Section 8 is to proceed. The second point that occurs to me is that there is a distinction between Section 8.1, which is a burning section, and Section 8.2, which at the moment is a cutting, grubbing or destroying section, but is the Minister now indicates is purely to be cutting. And that the difference is this, that it's very notable from the wording of Section 8.1 that it's proposed that it should apply to such part or parts of the state as the regulations may permit. But when you look to the regulations envisaged by Section 8.2, no such geographical criteria are there. And if we were considering a genuine pilot study to evaluate whether or not this should take place on scientific grounds, and bearing in mind the implications for wildlife and flora and fauna, one would expect that even from the point of view of having control studies and the like, that any scientific approach to a pilot study would look at areas where it was permitted and areas where it was not permitted, and see was there any significant difference between the two. I mean, I was interested that Michael Viney, in an article on this subject in the Irish Times, pointed out that there are particular species which do produce second clutches of eggs and chicks in August in each year, and the beekeepers of Ireland and the like have come forward with their objections based on the needs of bees in Ireland in terms of cutting back that year's growth. And that brings me to the next point that the Minister has mentioned in her contribution. She mentioned that the regulations which she had in mind would deal with roadside hedge cutting and non-roadside hedge cutting where it was necessary for land management in a tillage context. But I mean, why is that not mentioned in the section? And the reason that worries me, the particular point that I'm worried by in all of this is that it's all very well to say, I'm not doubting the Minister's good faith in this for a minute, it's all very well to say that the cutting would be restricted to the that year's growth, whatever that would mean for bees and the likes. And animals dependent on berries and all the rest of it. It's all very well to say that. But, if somebody brings a machine into a field and starts cutting, who is going to afterwards say you only got, or you went further than this year's growth? I mean, we're talking the real world. What inspector is going to be sent out, and by whom, to crawl along the hedges and say, really, you know, this has gone a bit further than this year's growth? It's 4 inches into last year's growth. And where are you going to actually draw the line between? I mean, people aren't going to be out with secateurs and measuring tapes and the like here. It's either a hedge cutting machine is going to be deployed on a hedge or it's not. And in the aftermath, there will be nothing to actually show really how far into last year's growth the cutting actually went. And it'll be there's going to be no person whose job it is to sort of say, I think you went further than this year's growth, because they'd have to prove that they were there last year and saw the state of the hedge last year. And
Shane Ross could do it.
Shane Ross could do it, indeed. I forgot about that. But if you are actually saying that that is the justification for this, how is anybody going to control that? And I come back to the point about it being a nationwide Section 2, the cutting, grubbing and destroying provision being a nationwide operation as Section 8.2 stands. I mean, there isn't the mechanism or the machinery or the resources or the capacity on the part of any wildlife agency or conservation body to really do anything effective to stop widespread cutting of hedges in August once an order is made under this regulation. Nobody will be able to police any regulations effectively. And from that point of view, I do have to say that it disturbs me that we aren't being shown. Well, first of all, I don't see why we're not being shown the draft regulation. I mean, we pass referenda and we see the draft bill. You know, the child adoption bill was put before the people. The abortion bill was put before the people. Various pieces of legislation are put before the people on occasions and divorce legislation was put before the people in draft form so they could work out what they were actually voting for. But on this occasion, no attempt has been made to produce a draft regulation which has the limiting factors such as tillage and land management and this season's growth. All of those issues are just simply absent from the legislation. And it does occur to me, Minister, that if this season's growth is to be a genuine criterion, there's absolutely no reason why it shouldn't be mentioned in the legislation. In respect of off-road hedge cutting. And therefore, I presume you're going to tell me before we go much further, that you'd accept an amendment at report stage to do that, because if you're not willing to say that, if you're not willing to put it into the legislation that it is intended to have that minor effect, there's no point in making a speech justifying it in this House by reference to something you're not willing to commit to in legislation. And likewise, if it's required for the purpose of land management, reasonable land management, what do we mean by that? If it's to be in a tillage context, let's see what is actually meant by all of that. What I'm really coming down to this is this. I mean, the amendment proposed is effectively putting in place a standstill until some scientific basis for a change in this area is established on scientific grounds. And that is the precautionary principle which we're supposed to follow in relation to environmental matters. And it does worry me that this seems to be a very unscientific approach. It seems to be a very broad brush approach. It seems to be one which, in effect, gives a free license to every farmer to attack any hedge Unless even if the minister took out grubbing and destroying, as long as there's something left at the end of the operation, the possibility of proving that any particular landowner had infringed the regulation would be very, very small indeed, and the chance of enforcing the regulations would be very, very small indeed. The last thing I just want to say is that I don't want to reignite the controversy which we just saw a moment ago. This isn't a question of the townies versus the farmers. This isn't the question of the idealists. I mean, all of us, or some of us, are very conversant with rural Ireland. Some of us know what it's like when a bramble grows out of a ditch and it forces bikes out on the road and all the rest of it. You don't have to have a particular background to appreciate what growth does take place and the road safety implications of roadside hedges growing out onto the road in summer can actually be. But I would say this to the minister. By the same token, although some people may get hot-headed on the social media and use broad-brush language about this particular proposal, you should not underestimate the feeling there is on this issue. It's not just that the Irish Times wrote an editorial on this and praised this House for querying what you're doing. There's a huge amount of people in Ireland who object to this. They object to its unscientific basis. They object to the manner in which it's been done. They object to the absence of draft regulations. They object to the unthought-out way in which this has been done. They object to what they suspect is that this is just a deal done with farmers' organisations. And that's why it's been pushed forward with such vehemence. And we live in a very uncertain world. But I actually do believe that if by any chance you progress this into legislation, this government has a lot of problems. I mean, you only have to look around what's happening in the last week. But this is going to alienate a very significant area of votes from you. And they're not just people who sit on beanbags and think of San Francisco in the 1960s or something like that. There's nothing wrong with Senator Ross's beanbag. And that's one advantage.
Please. Could we please come back to the matter?
But there's nothing. This is not a case of a minority of kind of tree huggers or a minority of people who are living in some idealistic world. This is real ordinary people who are quite upset about this. And it is a significant group in Irish society. And I would ask you, Minister, to consider the following. If you want to bring order to Irish waterways, and as somebody who uses them myself, I can't object to there being some order on the waterways, and somebody who might if resources are permitted, kind of enforce minimum standards of safety and the like in respect of the use of our canals and rivers. I have no problem about all of that. But I do ask you to consider this. I do think that by report stage, I think this legislation could do without Section 8. I don't think, to be honest with you, there's it would be regarded as a humiliation for you if you at this stage said, I'd like to think about it further. I really don't. And I think there are an awful lot of people outside this House who would say, get on with your Section 8. Get on with it and bring it. Get on with your bill and leave out Section 8. Those people, in my view, would be well disposed towards you if they thought that you had listened to a debate in this House where considered opposition to Section 8 has been voiced. I don't think it would do any harm to you electorally. I don't think it would do any harm to your ministerial standing. And as one of the people who admires many of the things you do, I don't think you would detract in the slightest if you were between now and report stage to reconsider your support for Section 8. I don't think the farming organisations would go mad if you modified Section 8 to deal with along the lines that you say you intend to do and you could do by restricting its application. But I do think that, you know, with so many political problems around your neck, this is not a case of you taking the hard decision in the national interest. It isn't. It doesn't fall into that category, and you shouldn't think of yourself as, and the government shouldn't think of itself as you know, making a hard decision with a whole load of intemperate, ill-informed critics voicing half-thought-out opposition. This is something where most people, and I think reasonably, would come down against Section 8 if they considered the issue, and most independent commentary comes down against Section 8. And therefore, I'd ask you to consider between now and report stage whether this bill would not be a far better bill if you walked away from Section 8 and said that you've listened to the debate in this House, that's what the Shannon is for, you haven't tried to push it through on a whip. The balance of opinion in society is against it, and there isn't a very good scientific basis for enacting Section 8 at this stage. In fact, there's none. And I would, in that spirit, and I'm not being rancorous or whatever, but I would say, you know, that you're not merely a minister through the chair. The minister is not merely a minister. She's also a politician. And I'm saying it would make good politics to delete Section 8 from the bill completely.
Humphreys.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I have to respond to your earlier remarks. I have to say...